The Greeks had the maxim, know thyself. How do we come to know ourselves in terms of our personalities and, more importantly, potential? Well, one of the first ways to come to know yourself is to understand that you don't. You know, you can learn to kind of watch yourself like you're watching a stranger. You watch what you say and you listen. You think, am I laying out a lie? Am I deceiving myself and other people? Am I adopting this personality at parties that is designed to impress and to amuse, and it comes across as nothing but self-centered narcissism? What are my dark fantasies? What are my aggressive fantasies? What is it that I'm willing to do? What am I interested in so that I'll spontaneously pursue it? What am I unwilling to do? What do I think is good? What do I congratulate myself for accomplishing? And what do I berate myself for failing to confront and to implement? Those are all incredibly complicated questions, and you don't know the answers to them. So that's a start.
And it's also Disco Elysium. Welcome to Yield Entertainment. My name is Alex, and it is my duty, my mission, my purpose in life to help you decide whether that game that you have been thumbing for so long is indeed the right game for you or not. But not today. Today I'm here to share my journey of spiritual death and resurrection, a journey of self-discovery, a journey through the darkness of the pale yonder, a journey of coming to terms with the past, but ultimately a journey of sacrifice and choice. But before I ask you to join me as I embark upon a voyage of reminiscence and cheap philosophy, a fair warning is in order, for there will be heavy spoilers. So let's get to it. So the game starts with you slowly regaining consciousness after a night of heavy partying, disco music, oceans of booze, and maybe even drugs. Your ancient reptilian brain and your limbic system tell you that there's nothing to worry about, as you're required to do nothing, and you're more than welcome to continue to drift off into nothingness. But this assertion is both true and not true. It is true because you may very well choose to continue down this path of reckless abandon and degradation, drinking heavily, partying hard, making a fool out of yourself, becoming a laughingstock in the eyes of everyone else around you in the best case scenario, or a shame to the world in the worst. Nothing else is required of you. The world will go on without you. Much like the tape player in your hotel room that keeps spinning endlessly, not giving a shit about the tape that's lying in utter disarray on the floor, the tape that it had surely been playing the night before. But it is also not true, because you will eventually become a nuisance, and at the very least, the hotel manager will come knocking on your door asking you to pay your debt, or else vacate the premises. You've been a drunker and a drug abuser. Your breath, your odor, and your monumental headache can account for that much. But beyond that, you don't remember the first thing about who you are, how you got there, or what is it that you're meant to do. In short, it's the perfect opportunity to start from scratch and become someone new. It's also the perfect opportunity to continue to be a buffoon who takes nothing seriously, drinks himself to death whenever he can, and tries to make good on every passing chance of mundane instant gratification. And thus starts your spiritual resurrection. This first room alone is a tour de force of allegories and metaphors unlike anything I had ever seen in any game. The blackness receding, the fetal position clinging to a bottle, the memory loss. It's a new day, a new life. So you let go the bottle as you struggle to get on your feet. A subtle metaphor of letting go the one thing that's keeping you from starting this new life. However pathetic the scene, it's a step in the right direction. So you pick up your clothes, which are purposefully distinctive of your personality and identity. You are a disco man, you are different, you're hip, you're out there. That was certainly important to you the night before, but will it continue to be important to you now? So you start collecting these clothes items one by one as though you were piecing together your identity once again. And once you're done with that, it's time to look in the mirror. Disco Elysium greets you into this world with nothing less than a quote from R.S Thomas, one taken from his poem titled Reflections. The furies are at home in the mirror. It is their address. Even the clearest water, if deep enough, can drown. So before its title was changed to Disco Elysium, the game was set to be titled No Truce with the Furies, which was indubitably meant to be a nod to Thomas's poem. But who are the furies? Thomas is no doubt referring to the Eringes. In Greek mythology, the furies are feminine spirits of vengeance. Alecto, punisher of moral crimes. Megara, punisher of infidelity, oath breakers, and theft. And Tisiphone, punisher of murderers. Disco Elysium never spits out the rest of the poem, but fear not, the old gamers got you covered. Never think to surprise them. Your face approaching ever so friendly is the white flag they ignore. There is no truce with the furies. A mirror's temperature is always at zero. It is ice in the veins. Its camera is an x-ray. It is a chalice, held out to you in silent communion, where gaspingly you partake of a shifting identity, never your own. And this is Disco Elysium, partly at least. But while Thomas focuses solely on the impossibility of escaping who you are, for these are shifting pieces that define an identity that you're not fully in control of, Disco Elysium, with its clever myriads of paths and relevant choices, proposes not a truce with the Furies, the bits of your identity, the demons of your past that'll come back in the form of various different voices, but coming to terms with all of it, accepting who you are and what you've done. It proposes coming to terms as a threshold into spiritual resurrection. So as you walk out of the room, you meet Klaasje, your next door hotel neighbor. In an attempt to learn a little bit about what happened last night, you ask her if she heard anything. Amongst other things, she mentions that you were listening to Ostentation's Orchestrations, some out-of-date disco band. She says you were yelling your lungs out to the chorus of the song, "Life gets hard, but we go on." Or I think that's how it goes. She says that you sounded like a wounded boar, which makes you wonder how she became acquainted with such a peculiar sound. That's neither here nor there. You sang like a drunken asshole and thrashed the place. But one thing that stood out to Klaasje was this. She says that you yelled that you didn't want to be this type of animal. Time to be a new type of animal then? Well, there's no better time than the present for that, is there? Disco Elysium wastes no time in presenting you with characters who make it abundantly clear that the world is not willing to forget who you are and what you've done, that regardless of the path you've decided to commit to, you still have to dance to the tune of the world around you, at least in some capacity, even if you can still decide whether you're going to dance disco or techno music. So you take the stairs to the ground floor of the Whirling Racks Hotel, where the world awaits you. And whatever else you are, whatever else you choose to do, you are a cop. And there's a murder you have to solve. As this mind-blowing piece of information is revealed to you, you're also presented with a bill of 130 real, which accounts for the regular fee of your stay at the hotel, plus the damages you've caused to the establishment, and all the booze you've drunk. The way in which you approach this situation is entirely up to you, and one of the best examples of what this coalition is all about. You may choose to apologize to the manager and promise to pay your debt. This will no doubt prove to be difficult, as you would have to find a way to amass a small fortune while you also pursue an investigation you couldn't be more ill-suited to commit to in your present state of amnesia. But because the new you is responsible and fully acknowledges the fact that it's not the hotel manager's fault that you decided to act like an irresponsible asshole over the course of the last 3 days, you decide to take responsibility and weather the shitstorm. You may also choose to blame the system, tell Garth the hotel manager to fuck off, and flee while giving him the middle finger in fantastically hilarious fashion. As it happens, the former approach may require your partner in the investigation, Lieutenant Kim Kitsuragi, to come to your rescue, which he does reluctantly. But even after paying your debt, Garth is still not impressed. You thrashed his hotel, spooked most of his clients, and made his employee quit, forcing him to take her shift. Neither is Kim Kitsuragi, who had to sacrifice some of his own resources to help you, a man he barely knows and with whom he has nothing in common beyond the fact that you're both police officers. Needless to say, if you instead refuse to pay your debts and decide to storm out the hotel while giving the manager the middle finger, there's a much greater chance that you'll be closing that hotel's door room for good. At least your room's door, that is. It would seem like there's no possible good outcome here, and that Disco Elysium is simply all hell-bent on rubbing your face in your own shit, and shaming you for how much of a lousy human being you've been up to this point. But see, just as it happens in real life, a lifetime of shitty decisions won't be fixed overnight by setting one thing right, but it's a step in the right direction, and if you're truly committed to being a new person, it surely won't be the last. If you walk the talk and keep yourself from being an alcoholic asshole who gives not a shit about anyone else or even himself, while committing to the job you have to do and avoid adding unnecessary fuel to the fire, by the end of the game you will have mustered a modicum of respect from Garth, and maybe even a great deal of respect and even admiration from your companion Kim Kitsuragi. As soon as you meet your partner Kim Kitsuragi on the ground floor of the Whirling Rags, you're faced with a task that would seem trivial and funny, and that's telling your name to your companion. But you don't remember your name. You have some options at your disposal, namely saying that you don't remember, or coming up with a name. If you lack the skill to come up with a believable name, you'll come up with Ambrosius Cousteau. Of course, your companion doesn't buy that shit and remains unimpressed. Later in the game, you learn that your name is Harry Dubois, but the thing with the name goes deeper than it originally seems. You can choose to accept that you don't know your name until you find your lost badge and ID, and then roll with it even if you don't like it at all. And it is suggested that Harry doesn't like his name at all. That's one way to come to terms with who you are and accept those things that you can't change. Jordan Peterson through his books and lectures, Ronald Thomas with his poetry, and Disco Elysium seem to agree on the statement that such would be the most beneficial way to go on about in life.
An identity isn't merely what you feel you are. An identity is way more complicated than that. An identity is
a role, a set of complex roles that you negotiate with other people so that you can thrive across a very long span of time. And it can't be something that you impose on other people, because then they won't cooperate with you. So for example, my granddaughter, who's about 3 at the moment, if you ask her who she is, she has 2 names. She's Ellie or Scarlett, and she's fine with either of those. But she's also Pocahontas. And if you ask her whether she's Ellie or Scarlett or Pocahontas, she will say Pocahontas. What she's doing is playing. So then the question is, what if you disrupt that play? That's fantasy play. And then you might say, well, maybe what you see happening in that case is that it bursts out in late adolescence. And the insistence there that my identity is what I say it is actually the scream in some sense of an organism that hasn't gone through that egocentric period of play where they are, in a fictional sense, exactly the way they define themselves. And so I see a fair bit of this as delayed fantasy play with the kind of pathology that comes up when you delay a necessary developmental stage.
Or you can deny that your name is Harry Dubois and continue to present yourself as Ambrosius Cousteau and impose upon others that they call you that, like Jordan Peterson's granddaughter, Little Miss Pocahontas. Regardless of which path you choose, the respect, admiration, scorn, disdain, or loathing from the characters in Disco Elysium is all you have to gain from your decisions. There's hardly any objects to be collected or skills to be gained by choosing to do this over that. It's one of many ways in which Disco Elysium tells you that it's not there to judge you. But in truth, the character's admiration, gratitude, or forgiveness is all you'll ever want from this title. Unlike most characters in most other RPGs, the characters in Disco Elysium aren't there as generic tokens who need something from you. In fact, they seem to be busy enough with their own affairs and issues to even pay attention to you in most cases. Some of the characters you'll encounter have deep takes on history, racial issues, and economy. Some others are simple people with ordinary lives and jobs. People who have, unknowingly, become entangled in someone else's political game. Some are obsessed with politics, and others with cryptids. There's insecure kids with tough exteriors, enthusiastic yet aimless teenagers who look like they may end up like you, and ignorant thugs who've come to fill those holes that inevitably come up when a weak state defaults on its promissory notes to its citizens. The death and rebirth of your spirit, navigating the depths of your fury-infested waters, and coming to terms with everything, would only make sense if it happened in a world filled with people who are capable of affecting you and whose lives you're interested in affecting in some capacity. The developers of Disco Elysium were well aware of this, so they squeezed their souls into this robust cast of characters by providing them with realistic fears, hopes, talents, dreams, superstitions, and most importantly, personalities. Kim Kitsuragi is your sidekick in the investigation. He's conveniently a level-headed guy who is squarely at the center of the political compass, left and right and up and down. He never judges you, and the rare times in which he emits judgment on your actions, it's in the interest of the murder case. The fact that he seems to be unbiased when it comes to most things makes him the perfect person to turn to when you need to know more about the world you've completely forgotten about, especially the police world. He doesn't think very highly of you at first, not because he has an opinion on you being a drunkard who seems incapable of taking anything seriously, but because drunkards are poor allies when it comes to solving crimes, and that's all he cares about, at least at first. René and Gaston are a couple of old men who spend their days playing pétanque, a game that resembles bocce. René is a hardened anti-communard, whose best days are behind him. He still speaks highly of the king who was overthrown by the communard revolution and the glory of the days in which he sided with a coalition of allies, the enemy of my enemy is my friend, to bring down the filthy communards. He's poor as piss though, and works a part-time job as watchman for the Union of Workers, an entity which acts as the de facto government of the district, a mob who loosely and hypocritically stands by principles that are similar to those held by the communards. Through René's story, it is implied that the Union dried the labor market, as these governments often do, to a point in which they could establish themselves almost as the sole job providers, thus all but completely controlling the labor market. But René is also friends with Gaston, a kind-hearted man who seems to stand on the opposite curb of the political street, though not as radically as his friend. Gaston's mild political inclination, his affable character and kind-hearted nature has kept his friendship with René alive all these years. There's also a story about them falling in love with the same woman, a girl who dated both men at some point, but eventually chose the less radical and smarter Gaston in favor of his politically obsessed friend. And while René still resents his friend for that, he's come to terms with it in his own way. In truth, his best bet, his only viable bet, is to remain friends with the only man who'll take the time to play pétanque with him, the only man who'll listen to his stories and trade insults with him, the likely story of an old lonely man. Listening to these two retell their stories adds nothing to the case, and you can completely bypass the old couple if you wish, but theirs is an everyday story you'll gladly hear while on the queue at the supermarket or while going home on the subway. It's realistic and humane. René eventually dies, and he dies the way he lived, reluctant to accept that he was in the wrong. René stubbornly refused to accept any handouts and pushed himself too hard at work, eventually leading to heart failure from overexertion. As he tells you this, Gaston keeps referring to René as an angry prick and an old cunt. But further into the conversation, if you say the right things, he'll admit that he loved René in spite of everything. Clostier is a crucial character, both to the story and to the statement that Disco Elysium seeks to make. She's the disco dancing lady who seeks to make a truce with the Furies. She's the one who's been punished the worst by them. Clostier has gotten herself into situations that have forced her into changing her identity several times. Who she is a mystery, even to herself. And like a certain cop we all know, she runs away from facing the past and the consequences of her actions, just as she would the plague. Lillian the netpicker is a simple woman, hardened by the harsh conditions she's had to endure, like everyone else who lives where she does, and the loss of her husband. She proudly provides a living for herself and her three children on fishing, like her late husband did. When you ask her about her husband, she explains that he died while he was out on the sea. He was drunk the day he died, as was usually the case, and he couldn't handle himself under particularly difficult weather. Lillian tells the story without a hint of resentment. You can tell that this woman has already come to terms with her past. Like many things in Disco Elysium, Lillian in particular resembles the pivotal character in Ronald Stuart Thomas's poetry. Lillian is the Welsh peasant in Thomas's poetry. Being Welsh himself, Thomas's work often represents the regular Welsh peasant in his struggle, a struggle that often comes from his worldly context. Literary critic Anthony Edward Dyson stated that, through this representation of the Welsh peasant, Thomas is making a universal statement. This pared-down existence in a land of ruined beauty belonging to the past is more human than any educated sophistication, or perhaps one should say, it is more truly symbolic of the human predicament. It's through characters like Lillian that Disco Elysium makes this statement as well. As for the land of ruined beauty belonging to the past, depicted in Thomas's poetry, one needs to look no further than Martinet, the main location in which the story of Disco Elysium takes place. Martinet is a downtrodden, godforsaken district in the city of Revachol, which is in turn spoken of as the disgraced former capital of the world, that world being a fictitious place called Elysium. Martinet is a melancholic mosaic of faded regal majesty scarred by missile craters, war-torn buildings, and abandoned ruins. Truly symbolic of the human predicament Thomas often wrote about in his poems. The lore in Disco Elysium speaks extensively of its geography. Elysium consists of large continents known as isolas. These isolas seem to be surrounded by an undefined matter called the Pale, a dark mantle of all-consuming nothingness that is slowly expanding upon the world. One supernatural being, later in the game, reveals that humans have unknowingly brought the Pale upon themselves and their world. It is not important to the plot how or why he knows this, so the creature reveals nothing more about it. It is nonchalantly dropped in a conversation that the curse of the commercial area, one that supposedly makes every business fail, might be spreading through Martinet like the Pale itself upon the world. It is also mentioned that there is a lot of failing going on in Martinet, as though its citizens had the Pale itself to cope with. But in this conversation, you can drop an answer along the lines of, and that curse? That failing? Is of the people's own making, much like the Pale that is devouring the world according to the supernatural creature, and much like your own nothingness taking over your life. At some point in the game, you may take up the task to investigate the aforementioned doomed commercial center. You may trick a superstitious bookstore owner into believing that you are some sort of paranormal researcher, and proceed into the cursed area of the building. The bookstore owner claims that an evil entity that has taken over the building is to blame for the whole affair. So after walking about the building past layers upon layers of various discarded business props, you finally run into the evil entity, which is no less than a human of all things. Not just any human though, as this is without a doubt the voice of the game's developer. And her name is Niha, a strange young woman who minds her own business while she listens to the radio. And her own business is that of novelty dice crafting. The novelty dice maker's business is located inside the chimney of an old central furnace, on the second floor of the building. In a way, it is well removed from the other rooms in the building, just like the dice maker herself seems to be detached, almost oblivious to everything that's been happening in and around the building. So you and the dice maker engage in a long conversation about the curse that's supposedly looming over the place. And though you're offered a broad array of dialogue options, some of which even allow you to buy into the whole curse nonsense, the truth is laid out simply but unequivocally. All those businesses failed because they had bad business plans. Only they are to blame for their own failure. Niha's business seems to be the exception to the rule of the curse. When you start exchanging theories about why that is, she eventually starts laughing and shows you a piece of metal shining on her index finger. She says the item is a mourning ring. I made this when my first company failed, It was a small jewelry shop right here in Delta Commerce Center, built with the little I inherited from my parents. I drove it to the ground within a year. I didn't have what you would call a viable business plan. This encounter with Nia is both shrouded in mysticism and also very extremely mundane at the same time. It is also very meta, as the game itself relies on dice roll mechanics, much like classic tabletop RPGs. It's shrouded in mysticism because it's a solid metaphor of the game of life, and this is your one window of opportunity to talk to the dice maker. In a way, all she has to say is that she only makes the dice, but it's up to you to make the rolls. And as the poet Ronald Stuart Thomas himself would have surely liked to put it, you have no control over the outcome. And as she puts it herself, nothing ever works the way you want it. But then again, she also says, that's the way of the world. You're supposed to try again until you finally succeed. Disco Elysium speaks to you through Nia, inviting you to reflect upon yourself. That's why people like role-playing games, she says. You can be whoever you want to be. You can try again. Still, there's something inherently violent about dice rolls. It is like every time you cast a die, something disappears. Some alternative ending, or an entire different world. And as someone who used to constantly beat himself over the head about every bad decision he's made, and about every opportunity he's wasted, I can wholeheartedly agree with this assessment. It is also an early warning about what you can expect from Disco Elysium, and a warning of how things work in real life too. Through Niha's little anecdote about her own business, the game makes the statement that in the long run, the outcome of the rolls might have an impact on your game, making things easier or harder circumstantially, maybe even stripping you of alternatives at times. But ultimately, you'll end up where your decisions take you, whether the die makes the road bumpy or smooth. The game has lines of thought. These are concepts that you can elaborate further upon through research or simply by reflecting upon them. One such line of thought is titled The Precarious World, and it is Disco Elysium's way to stress Niha's statement. How not to lose, the thought goes, it is impossible not to. The world is balanced on the edge of a knife. It's a game of frayed nerves. You're pushed down by numbers and punitive measures, pain, rejection, and unpaid bills. You can either play, or you can crawl under a boat and waste away, turn into salt or a flock of seagulls. Your enemies would love that. Or you can fight. The only way to load the dice is to keep fighting.
Stand up straight with your shoulders back. It's a vulnerable position, right, because you're open. But it's a powerful position because it means that you're brave enough to take what's coming. And it isn't like what's coming isn't dangerous. It's dangerous. So, but your best bet is to be dancing on your feet and ready for it.
My conversation with the dice maker ended with me asking her to give me whichever dice she thought suited my personality best. She chooses two polyhedrons, red and blue. The spree, the court voice within me adds police colors. And she ends with one final recommendation on how to play the game. Sometimes the obvious choice is obvious because it's best. The game creators reward you for having this conversation with them by having Nia toss the dice at you while saying catch. Of course, you'll have to roll the dice for a hand-eye coordination check to determine if you can catch them. At first glance, Disco Elysium's main quest has to do with solving someone's murder. But the game is designed in a way that makes it abundantly clear that its main quest is really about solving the mystery of your own spiritual death. Solving this mystery is also presented as the one thing you have to do if you are to navigate through your personal pale, if you would, into your spiritual rebirth. So you start your journey by choosing those things you're meant to be particularly good at. These things are presented as straightforward RPG attributes and skill mechanics, so your intellect determines the limits of your skill for logic and conceptualization, for example. The way in which these skills come to your aid in the game, though, is anything but standard. Every skill, the ones you're good at and the ones you aren't, take the form of inner voices. Sometimes they add much-needed context to a situation, sometimes they give advice or relevant information, and sometimes even they make fun of you. One interesting and funny thing about these skills is that the better you are at them, the more useful their recommendations and input will be. It's also hilarious to see your skills arguing about what's the best course of action for a given situation. These skills are indeed your better judgment. Your perception skill, for example, tells you when someone is nervously wringing an object in his or her hand. It even speaks to you and says things like, she's lying. The conceptualization skill, for example, is capable of looking into art in a deeper way and interpreting useful things. Your encyclopedia skill is capable of pulling history and geography lessons from the damaged clusters of your brain. Your skills don't always offer the best advice, though. You may, for example, talk Lillian into walking with you on the shore. That's the closest thing you're going to get to a date in Disco Elysium. The game makes it abundantly clear that before you even consider bringing anyone into your life, you must clean the mess in your room first, so to speak. Lillian is matured in season enough to tell you with cool transparency that a walk is as far as that rendezvous is going to go, but she still accepts to walk with you. At some point during your encounter, while you're watching the sun come out, she says, isn't it strange for this all-powerful thing, the sun, to be so generous towards us? It's a simple remark and beautiful in its own way, and the best things your skills can come up with are, the sun does little for the dead and those hopelessly lost in their own minds. Or, or people living in desert climates with sparse vegetation and little drinking water. Sometimes the obvious choice is obvious because it's best, and if you're not hopelessly nerdy or with sparse common sense, you can easily tell that the best option is to tell your brain to fuck off and just enjoy the view. As you navigate Martinet and interact with its people and objects, you will encounter windows of opportunity to piece together your identity and help you get closer to solving the mystery of your spiritual death. There are situations in which your skills will act in unison as they try to prevent you from doing something that might turn out to be tremendously harmful to your psyche. In my experience, most of the situations your skills try to safeguard you from have to do with you digging up things from the past. And many of those things have to do with your failed relationship with your wife-to-be and how it all went to shit because of the things you did. You may listen to your skills and never open that letter that's come into your possession. You may never fiddle with that bubblegum wrap with the lingering scent of apricots. You may decide not to experiment with your muscle memory and that public telephone. And you may desist in your efforts of figuring out what is it that the image of the deity Dolores Day reminds you of. The statement Disco Elysium seeks to make is unmistakable. You may indeed listen to all these voices in your head as they try to help you surf around these potentially harmful situations, like revisiting your last memories with your wife-to-be. But in doing so, you'll be robbing yourself of the opportunity to face your past and come to terms with it. You're a mess of a human being, and there's a lot hidden away within the confines of your mind that you have to bring closure to. Losing your memory is a step in the right direction, or rather a natural step in the process of death and rebirth of your spirit, but also an obstacle when it comes to coming to terms with the stuff that's holding you back. Stuff you may even punish yourself about while looking at yourself in the mirror, letting those furies punish you for who you are and what you've done. The world around you in Disco Elysium is filled with avatars of characters who are at the core of your internal struggle. The abandoned church, adequately located in the middle of nowhere, is the darkest and scariest place in Martinet. It houses the image of deity Dolores Day. Your companion Kim Kitsuragi and your encyclopedia skill tell you everything you need to know about her. The short version is that she is an innocence, which is apparently the pinnacle of divinity in Disco Elysium lore. And although you don't know why, Harry rejects her presence and finds her distressful, which makes it all the more shameful given the fact that everyone adores her without question. Dolores Day is the proxy avatar through which you reach the memory of your ex-wife-to-be Dora and bring closer to the situation of lingering guilt that you feel for having ruined your relationship with her. The game states this unmistakably through your encyclopedia skill. No amount of Commodore Red can wipe her sad smile from your brain thing. It has survived the deluge and haunts you still. And it will haunt you forever. During your last oniric encounter with your wife-to-be in the form of Dolores Day, you revisit painful memories of the events that transpired between the two of you that ultimately led to her leaving you. At some point during this conversation, you say, "This is intolerably bad." And Dolores Day replies, "Oh yes, this is real darkness. It's not death or war or child molestation. Real darkness has love for a face. The first death is in the heart, Harry." The abandoned church is arguably the most important location in the game. Harry's silent battle with his past with Dora, represented in Dolores Day's figure, is not the only pivotal moment that takes place in that location. There's an exiled failed programmer, looking into some strange happenings at the very center of the church. The phenomenon is described as a black hole of sorts that vacuums energy, light, and even sound. Standing at a certain place in the center of the church makes the world go completely silent. You are given the opportunity to hypothesize about why this is happening. One of the explanations establishes that the strange void is a part of the pale itself. There, at the very core of the church, under the eternal gaze of Dolores Day herself. There's also a bunch of messy, misguided teenage techno music lovers who are also fond of drinking and substance abuse. When you talk to them in their tent in the middle of nowhere, they reveal their plan to turn the church into a raving techno haven. What they don't tell you, however, is that in order to finance their musical endeavor, they plan to turn the church into a drug processing lab. Being both a seasoned detective and a seasoned alcohol and drug abuser, Harry knows the score. As a player, you have plenty of options on how to deal with this bunch. It makes sense, though, to let the little hooligans know that they aren't fooling you and that you know what their plan is. One thing that remains consistent about Harry's character throughout the game, regardless of what choices you make, is that he was at one time fond of partying and most especially disco music. So it makes sense to see a little bit of yourself in these kids. But if you are truly committed to this new version of yourself who truly seeks to be a better individual, it makes sense to help these kids start their techno joint at the church on the condition that they relinquish their plan to also turn it into a drug lab. In Greek mythology, Elysium is a conception of the afterlife, a heightened place separated from the realms of Hades, a place reserved for those chosen by the gods, the righteous and the heroic. It was Dolores' day will to bring Elysium to everyone, and the church is the place in which it all comes together for you. You help the kids turn the church into a techno joint, even after you've established that the very pale dwells at the center of the place, if only in the form of a minuscule 2mm breach. You even find a way to make the kids' music truly hardcore, and out of respect and admiration for your musical hardcoreness, they defer to your better judgment to give the place a name. And that's when you conquer your world. Disco Elysium, you say triumphantly as you establish the place as a sanctuary for brave and heroic, if a little chaotic, disco freaks like yourself. It is the ultimate balance of order and chaos, as you come to terms with your past and the nothingness nested in your heart, while you let chaotic lights and hardcore disco music inject some youthful life into those old bones of yours. Kim Kitsuragi deserves his own video. He's a fellow police officer, a level-headed dude who would fit the lawful neutral archetype if it weren't for the fact that in his profession, and especially while he's dealing with people like you, he has no option but to welcome some chaos into his life. Professionalism is his coping mechanism, as one of your inner voices establishes at some point in the game, but it is also his way of life. But much like yourself, Kim is not above spouting humorous, cynical remarks every now and then. Tongue-in-cheek cynical remarks constitute the trademark humor of smart but tormented men. It is also one of Disco Elysium's most important war horses. If you truly commit to putting your disastrous self behind you, the game offers one fairly obvious path forward, which is to make your best to solve the murder. Every effort you put into getting things done for the investigation will be acknowledged and maybe even celebrated by Kim. Ronald Stuart Thomas's poetry and Dr. Jordan Peterson's scientific remarks establish well enough that your identity is greatly shaped by means of your interaction with people around you. And again, if spiritual rebirth and personal growth are part of your agenda, chances are you're going to want to try and be useful in that interaction.
You have to figure out how to gratify all those internal demons in a sustainable way, in a way that other people not only don't object to, but probably help you with, and that benefits them at the same time. Well, then you think, well, there just aren't that many ways of solving that problem. And we know some of them. One of them is reciprocity. You know, like, if you go out of your way for me, it's incumbent on me to notice that and to attempt in some manner to repay you.
When the time comes to undertake that final mission and sail to the abandoned fortress in the atoll, Kim may or may not be by your side. If you have continued to be a careless asshole who's all about indulging his darkest passions and not giving a shit about anyone else or even himself, Kim Kitsuragi will surely have left you by that time, just as the real people around you will eventually leave you if you demonstrate that you don't give a shit about them or yourself, which will leave you to navigate the pale in your final days all by yourself. But if you have taken yourself and your job seriously, he'll jump into that boat with you as you both set off to brave that final stretch. You may even ask him to handle the engine. So the final pieces of the puzzle await you at the abandoned fortress at the atoll. There's one mattress for you to take the final nap to drift off into the dream world and have one last oniric encounter with Dolores Day, or Dora, to finally bring closure to that part of your past. You also find the killer you've been searching for all along and extract all the answers you need from him to solve the case. But most importantly, you find yourself. And like many other things in Disco Elysium, you do this through an encounter with a proxy avatar of yourself. This time is the Insulindian Phasmid, a cryptid giant insect-like creature, a creature believed by most to be non-existent, a unique creature that had kept itself hidden from humanity because it considered the entire species to be dangerous. Your companion Kim Kitsuragi, who initially was the most skeptical about the existence of the Insulindian Phasmid, stands in awe and admiration of the creature. Just like he didn't initially think you had it in you to put your self-destructiveness and your immature buffoonery behind you, but eventually came to appreciate your ways and even admire you for the efficiency of your unconventional methods. Properly enough, the Phasmid chooses you as the first human to reveal itself to. Only you are able to communicate with the creature. He tells you his story while Kim stands there wondering what's going on between the two of you. He's a rare and noble creature that is coming out to the world for the first time in ages, just like you are after your journey of self-discovery. He reveals that the Pale is of human make, and that it will eventually consume all there is, just like your own sorrows are of your own making. And they are something you must come to terms with before you move on to a new life. Apart from you, Kim Kitsuragi is the first person to acknowledge the presence of the creature. He has also been accompanying you all this time on your mission to solve the murder. And as a byproduct, he has also been accompanying you on your journey of spiritual resurrection. So he's also the first to witness the birth of the new you. As you walk Harry back to the boat, you come to the realization that nothing in your experience with this Elysium has been an accident. Harry Dubois being in his 50s was not an accident. Him being in his 50s goes a long way in strengthening the idea that it's never too late to wake up and say, I want to be a different kind of animal. Kim Kitsuragi being a level-headed centrist individual who cared very little about you being a drunken waste of a man was no accident. It was the game's way of telling you that initially, most people won't give two shits about who you are or what you do beyond the one thing they expect from you. If you're a teacher, people expect you to teach them. If you're a doctor, people expect you to cure them. If you're a cop, people expect you to put the bad guy behind bars. And at some point in life, that's your first step towards being someone else to people. But be certain of this. If you're a doctor and you fuck that up, don't expect to become your patient's best friend anytime soon. The fact that you found yourself choosing very carefully what to say to the people in Martinet, in the hopes that they'll tell you what you need to know for the case, or just because you want them to like you, was no accident. That's Disco Elysium's way of telling you that that's how you find your place in the world, that's how you build your identity even, and most especially, that you're never fully in control of it. Being serious and focused is consistently the best way to get the best results in Disco Elysium, but saying something unconventional or even weird from time to time will open doors that would otherwise remain closed, and this is no accident. It's Disco Elysium's way of telling you that balancing chaos and order in your life is the way forward. Disco Elysium could have been an exploration game like Outer Wilds, it could have been a linear story-based adventure game like What Remains of Edith Finch, it could have, but it was not. It was a role-playing game, and this was no accident. You have strengths and weaknesses like every human being. A strong hand-eye coordination skill will enable you, for example, to shoot the cargo belt loose to bring down the corpse from the tree. If you lack that skill, you'll have to go to someone else for help, and that will no doubt come with strings attached. The use of traditional die-casting mechanics in Disco Elysium, as stated by Niha the Dice Maker, the game's developer's voice, is there to make the statement that fate may decree the outcome of the role, but it's up to you to make the cast. Some situations may be easier to navigate if you have the appropriate skill, and some doors may open or close if the roll of the dice favors you. Hell, things can even go very, very wrong at times and even force you into doing things you don't agree with. But at the end of the day, at the end of the game, the kind of person you commit to being and the decisions you make will end up dictating the path you follow, and most especially, the final outcome. But most importantly, you watching this video all the way up until now is no accident. Disco Elysium changed my life forever. For a long time I mourned, every job I botched, every relationship I ruined, every train I let go, every opportunity I've missed, and every choice I made that, I know for certain, ended up closing some very important doors in my life. It's like every time you cast a die, something disappears, some alternative ending, or an entire different world. I don't know what the next roll of the dice will bring, and I know there is no truce with the Furies, but I chose to live with it, and I chose to become a different type of animal. And that has been liberating.
Maybe you don't know yourself as well as you think, but it's hard to get low enough to understand how deeply it is the case that you are ignorant about who you are. Now, there's an upside to that too, which also is that you're also ignorant about who you could be. And so the discovery of that, you know, is some reward for the horror of determining who you actually are.